Brad, have you ever heard the phrase, drinking is borrowing happiness from tomorrow?
No, but it makes perfect sense to me.
I'm pretty hungover. I'm pretty rough today. I tore it up last night at a pre-Halloween Halloween party.
Yeah?
Yeah. It's my favorite holiday.
I went to the Husker game yesterday.
Yeah?
I was doing a lot of day drinking, but I can't maintain anymore. You know, if I do that by 8 o'clock, I'm out.
That was my problem, is I can't recover like I used to.
I know.
It tastes so good when it goes in, but then the next day I'm like, what the like, why did you do it? I'm always like, in my head, I'm always the like the stereotypical angry wife, like, you know, you're not supposed to have 12 beers in an hour, you know, like that. And like, shut the fuck up.
I would say I have a love-hate relationship with whiskey. I love it.
Oh, my God, I love whiskey.
I love to drink it until I hate everything. One of my favorite jokes is this comedian. Ever heard of Tom Rhodes?
Yeah.
He does
a
great podcast, too, Tom Rhodes Radio, where he has comedians from all over the world come on there.
Really?
But he's got one of my favorite whiskey jokes. He goes, I had to stop drinking Jack Daniels because one night I broke my leg. I thought it called me an asshole.
Yeah, I've had those nights. I love Jack Daniels. I love any type of whiskey.
Me too.
Yeah. People are, I have a real bad problem of, like, I'll start out with beer, and I'll just, I call it like jumping drinks.
Yeah.
I jump all over the place, and it's like, it doesn't matter if it's a beer or
that's
or
your
a mixed
problem.
Drink.
That's
oh, yeah.
What I learned a long time. You stick with, what I do now is I just drink beer and then shots of Jameson in between there.
Yeah. That's, I know. And again, like, it's like I have amnesia every time I drink, because I'm like, didn't I learn from the last time and the last time and the last? No, every time it's always, oh, yeah, give me some beers
that's
and
like,
then we'll kick
like
it up.
That's like how a college freshman or a newly 21-year-old drinks.
I know. I'm almost 30 and I still haven't figured it out.
Give me a Bud Light. Now give me a Whiskey Coke. Now give me a shot of tequila. Now give me a Fireball. And I'll take another Fireball. And
yep. And that's exactly what happened this morning. Oh, it was rough. I'm glad that I got you, because in my episode with Jake Brandt, he had mentioned you. And so I started following
sweetheart
you.
Sweetheart of a human being.
He's the man, Smudgy Bear. I started.
Which I just learned that was a nickname for him as you came over.
See, after that episode, now people are going to start calling him Smudge again. Yeah. He's going to get upset, because he's like, I thought that nickname
grew
was
it.
Dead.
It's over.
I started following you on Facebook. And I like to share people's events.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess on a side note on that, I'm really bad about, I would rather, I feel like if you have an event on Facebook, it looks better to people if a lot of people are saying they're going.
Right.
So
yeah.
I always say I'm going, even if I know I'm never going to be around. And I always get in shit for it, because people are like, they'll message me like, oh, sweet, you're going to be there? Because they know I work out of state.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh, no, I won't. They're like, why did you say you're fucking going then? It always ends up like that, but I would rather, you know, wouldn't you rather me
say
I'm going?
I like going. Interested is not going. Like,
that's what I
generally
hate.
Interested is like not interested. Then
yeah.
That's kind of, but they're trying to do the same thing. You're like trying to be supportive.
Right.
But I like what you do, you know. I might have in the past been a little butthurt by that, but not anymore. Now I'm like, yeah, because I agree. Even just I do two shows a week. So
right.
A lot of times I'll get behind on stuff, and mm-hmm. especially if I've had a big show the week before that I've been extra pushing.
Right.
And then I'll slack on the next week, and I won't get the event up. Like the event for the show tonight at the Zoo Bar,
right.
I didn't get the event up until like Friday, early Friday. And then some smart-ass motherfucker in Omaha, I don't even know who it is. We have a lot of mutual comedian friends, so I assume he's a comedian or an open mic comedian that wants to be a comedian.
Right.
But he puts, one interested and one going. Maybe they should call in the extra barbacks. And I was like, ha, 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 it's so funny. How's your weekly comedy show doing?
Exactly. That's what
drives
me. And
he goes, lighten up, Francis.
That shit drives me crazy.
Maybe if I knew you, that might be funny to me, but I don't know who you are. You're just coming off as like a troll douche.
Exactly. The trolls drive me nuts. And it's hard on Facebook because it's like with the episodes when I put them out on the podcast, I have to time it right, because like usually I put them out on Sundays because everyone's mm-hmm. hungover, they're not doing anything, and that's like the best day I can get people to download it.
Right.
But like this weekend, I was in Kansas yesterday, pretty much Oklahoma. I was so far south. Drove all the way up here, went to that part. I mean, I knew my weekend is too booked to put it out.
Mm-hmm.
So I put it out. Well, of course, it just gets wiped out by every fucking Husker
right
thing, you know, because no one, it's just buried somewhere in Facebook now.
Right.
But the same thing with events. The interested drives me fucking crazy because it's like, are you going or are you not? Because it's like, it sounds like a pity, like.
Yeah.
Like, yeah, if I'm not doing anything, I guess I'll stop by. But because I have an invite right now for my birthday. I'm having it up here in December at like McKinney's Pub. I've never been there, but it looks pretty sweet. Mm. So I figured that'd be a lot easier to do that than a party bus.
Mm-hmm.
But all these people keep putting interested. And I'm like, what the fuck does that mean? I mean, are
it
you...
It sounds like they want to be talked into it.
I'm interested, but what else can you offer me?
If there's something better going on than your birthday...
Any drink specials? That could change my interested to going real quick if I could get some cheap booze.
That's what I wouldn't get. Those fucking cheap motherfuckers. Any beer specials there? No? Oh, I'm not coming. Uninterested.
Yeah, I'm glad there's not an uninterested button. I would look at that and just feel like shit.
I guess
there used to be a not going.
Yeah, exactly.
And I would just look at that and go, well, fuck you.
Exactly.
I'd be like, you can put nothing. That's putting not responding and ignoring it is better than putting not going. That's like, you took the time and effort to go, not going.
Not going. I hated it. Back in the day, I still cannot fucking remember where it's at, but there was a place I used to host open mics in Omaha.
Mm-hmm.
And that's when I always got the not going.
Yeah.
And I was like, I would just rather you just not respond than say
perfect.
That. Because then when people get on there and they see, you know, 2 going, 30 not going, they're like, why would I even acknowledge? Yeah. You know what I mean? Stupid. But I am actually going to Zoolarius tonight. I'm excited. Cool. I've never even been to the Zoo Bar.
That's the best place. I love it.
And I have a pretty bad habit of drinking. I mean, I enjoy it. It's fun. You'd think that I would have been there at least at one point, but it looks like they have a lot of cool shit going on there.
That's my favorite live music venue by far because it's small. It's not very big. And it's got history, which is, it's been around for, I think, 43 years, coming up on 44.
Wow.
And it started out strictly blues. It was fashioned after the old blues joints in Chicago. Like, it's like a long and skinny, kind of like a shoebox shape.
Right.
But they have all these old bills on the wall from everybody that's ever performed there before.
Nice.
Now they get just because they can't do blues 7 nights a week like they used to. So they get all kinds of different bands. But they're always really, really good bands. The people in charge of booking that place are usually musicians themselves or Pete, who's the owner, who's got really good taste in music. So pretty much any night of the week you can go there, except for Sundays where there's a stupid comedy show.
A dumb comedy. Waste of time.
Which I'm sure Zumar purists think that because there's people that have been going there since it started. You know, people like in their 60s. And
Yeah,
I'm sure that they hate that there's this comedy show there. Stupid comedy dreams. Play some blues.
What is
I would say the comedy is the blues. Just set the jokes.
It really is. What is Zoolarius exactly?
It's just a comedy. It's a comedy showcase, you know?
Okay.
It's like a feature show. Because I'm so fucking witty. I was like, I thought the Zoo Bar, it's hilarious. It's Zoolarius.
I just... somebody asked me the other day when I shared the event.
It's a pretty dumb name, but I just came... It works.
They asked me if it was like an open mic, and I go, no, I think it's actual like showcase, like a feature show.
It is.
Okay. Mm-hmm. That's excellent.
Yeah, that's because people get confused because all Lincoln's ever had, they've had a few comedy clubs that have come and gone and just didn't last. And
yep.
I don't know the reasons for that, but I think one, probably Husker football, because I think, you know, Saturday nights are usually good nights for audiences at comedy clubs, but if there's a Husker game, forget it. And even if there's an early Husker game and you had a show, all you're going to get is drunken Husker fans in there. It's just going to be
the worst.
A nightmare.
That's... back in the day, I DJ'd for like 10 years, and I would tell people all the time, do not book your wedding on a Husker game, home game. You can get away with it for an away game, maybe, but home game, it's...
You're going to have pissed off family members that are not paying attention or like...
Yeah, every time.
Running out of the church, they'd pop in the car and check the score or... Cursing you when your significant other's name the whole time.
one of the worst ones I ever had was, it was here in Lincoln, and their theory sounded good, but I was like, this is going to be a disaster, and it was that we had a game, like, I don't know, early, like 11 o'clock, and they thought if we have the reception that night, people will go to the game and then go to the reception. Mm-mm. No, they went home because they passed out.
Right.
Everyone was fucking hammered. And oh my God, it was like I can still see it in my head because I'm looking out. The room is completely empty. It had been for hours. The waiter is asleep at a table. The bartender is just like back there, like just hunched over, like this is so boring. And it's like 5 till midnight. No one is in the building. And they come up and tell me, you can go ahead and play like 2 more songs and go ahead and end it. And I'm like, yeah, it's ended right now. Yeah. We're done. 2 more songs is not going to, no one's going to say
give
one
me,
more
give
song.
Give me my DJ set or the marriage.
It was always like that.
Yeah.
I've read all the bios and all that, but I still like to always hear it from the person themselves.
Okay.
How long have you been doing comedy?
I started in Los Angeles in about the end of 95, 96, so about 20 years. And keep in mind, 10 of those years were open mics and just
right.
you know, trying to get on showcases in L.A. and struggling. And then about the early 2000s, I had this agent that, well, it took a liking to me. I sent a video cassette, a VHS tape. I'll still say that even if I'm sending the DVD. I'm like, I sent him my tape.
You know, I was watching American Psycho this morning, and there's this scene where he has like the two hookers, and he like sets up the tripod camera because he wants to record them while having sex. And I was like, my God, I do not miss the days of those huge cameras. Like, it's like, do you know how much work you had to do to make a sex tape back then? Yeah. Now it's like, just turn your phone on or
right,
whatever.
Right.
But that was a legit setup just to show somebody fucking.
Yeah.
But see, like in your, when I read your, the quick bio on your website, the way that I see it when I read that is you started in 95 and then it kind of jumps to what year did you start opening for Joan Rivers?
2010.
Now, see, when I read that, all what I see is this guy worked a lot. He had to do a lot of shows, a lot of this all over the place to get to that point.
Yeah.
So when you started in Los Angeles, are you from there originally?
No, I'm from here. I'm from Nebraska, born and raised. I was like you. I was obsessed with stand-up comedy.
Right.
But I was always I was a theater major at UNL.
Really?
And so I was just, I moved to LA purely to be an actor. And then I entered a comedy, but I'd always loved stand up comedy. I dabbled in it and I was in an improv group in, here in Lincoln. And so when I got out to LA, just out of frustration of not landing any agents or managers or auditions or anything,
right.
I just wrote up a comedy act and I entered a comedy contest and I ended up winning the whole thing. I won like $500 and I was like, wow, this is easy. Be huge,
right?
nothing forever after that. Just you know, waiting tables and doing comedy at night.
What triggered the decision in your mind to move to LA as opposed to somewhere else?
I just always wanted to move to LA. I don't know why. Maybe it's because I hate winter.
Right. Yeah, I can see that.
Yeah, and I just always had Hollywood. Like ever since I was a kid.
Right.
You know? So I just always, that was a plan I had from a really young age. I was going to move to LA and be an actor and.
Interesting. Were you more focused acting-wise in comedy acting, or was it just any type of acting?
That's always where I excelled the most. But,
gotcha.
I liked it all. You know, I wanted to do it all. I wanted to do drama. And you know, I'd done theater camp in high school because I was that cool in high school. Then when I got to UNL, I was in a few of the main stage. I was in a Shakespeare play, Twelfth Night, and then I was in this play called Scapino, which is like an Italian farce. So it was me and who's still one of my best friends to this day. We played Italian waiters who didn't have any dialogue. We just had to do physical comedy on stage, and that was a blast.
Interesting. I bet it was. That's very interesting.
And then I went for just a couple semesters, and I was like, I don't need to get a teaching certificate, and I don't need a theater degree. I'm moving to LA now.
Right.
As soon as I turned 21, like 2 weeks after I turned 21, I moved to LA with $600.
That was my next question.
I was an idiot. My parents helped me early on when I was there. You know, I don't know, I wouldn't have been able to survive. And then,
right.
And then it was just hand to mouth pretty much the entire time I was there. So,
when you got out there, I mean, did you have a plan? I mean, did you just say, it's 21?
I went to Barnes & Noble and bought all the books and how to get an agent and what to do, and I sent out headshots and resumes and didn't get hardly any interest at all.
Really?
And then there was a few times that, like, kind of like some shady people, like, met with me at a coffee house, and I'm thinking, this is awesome. And
right.
But they want money from me, and they're not supposed to ask for money from you. That's like, you're already... piece of shit if you're right. doing that. You get paid when I get paid. That's the whole way it works.
Yep. When you got out there and started doing comedy, what was it like back then?
It was a wasteland. I mean, it was 95, 96, so the comedy boom had already happened and exploded. Right. The comedy bubble had already was... So there wasn't... Not like it is now. I mean, there was hardly anybody doing stand-up, you know?
Interesting.
Like, it helped build my confidence up, because I think today there's way more better comedians now than there were back
then.
Oh,
my God.
People are just savvy, more savvy about it.
Yeah.
But I saw the birth of alternative comedy. I've always hated that phrase, because I just think comedy's comedy, funny's funny.
Right.
And, the people that came up in that, like Janine Garofalo and Louis C.K. and Patton Oswalt, all those guys started out in comedy clubs. They wrote set up punchlines, and they just got kind of bored of that 80s style of comedy.
Right.
And so they started bringing their personalities into it more, and it became more of a storytelling. But if you listen to those stories have set up some punchlines in them.
Right, for sure.
Because you'll see young comics, I think, oh, I'm just going to get up and tell a story, you know. Talk about 90s hipster references, and I'll be good. No, you need to have the fundamentals. You know what I mean?
Yeah, and it's almost like a song. Like you get, mm-hmm. it's like really good comedians have kind of like a beat. Mm-hmm. You can almost I listen to it all the time. That's why I talk about it too much on this podcast. Yeah. But the Todd Glass Show's podcast.
Yeah,
and he always will just randomly break into old Rodney Dangerfield stuff. But he doesn't even say the word sometimes. He just like. Does that, the mumble.
Yeah.
And when you hear him, you're like, he's not even saying a word, and it sounds just like how he would build it up. Yeah. And you're like, yeah, holy shit, it is him. And he's so good at it because it sounds just like him.
But Todd Glass had a heart attack on stage one time, and he was still doing his bit when they were putting him on the stretcher.
I don't know. Did he?
Yeah.
I wouldn't fucking doubt it.
There's a place called Largo, I think, in L.A. It's a really great place to see live comedy. But yeah.
That's awesome.
I wasn't there. I think I'd already moved back to Nebraska at that point.
But, yeah.
But that place is still to this day one of the best places to see comedy if you're ever in L.A. is Largo and Nerd Melt. The show, they have a Comedy Central show now.
I can't think of what
it's
called.
The Meltdown, it's called.
There you go. Yeah.
That's probably the best comedy showcase in L.A. has been for the last 5 or 6 years.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
That's
kind of show. Well, you never know who's going to pop. Jim Gaffigan might pop in to try new material out. You'll see Sarah Silverman hanging out in the back.
Right.
Louis C.K. might pop in. Mark Maron will pop in. That's the place to see people. You mean they'll pop into the improv and bigger places like that too, but it's more intimate, and it's just got a cool vibe to it. I miss that about L.A., those kind of shows where you can just pop in, and sometimes it's free, sometimes it's $5, and you're going to see some heavy hitters of comedy trying out new material. It's like...
Yeah, that's the thing, is those big comedy clubs are out there, like the big name, I guess I'll say. Mm-hmm. But the smaller venues is where people, you don't want to work out new jokes in front of 200 people.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, it's not going to hit well if it blows. I mean, it's so much better with, the smaller, tighter venues.
Right.
No, I tried to explain that to somebody. Like, when I first got out of college, I was doing open mics and stuff like that through college. And then when I got out and I had to travel a lot, every time I was in a town, I would always try and do stuff. And I had gotten, it was always a fucking headache because when I was in Kansas City, I would always get into competitions and I would get to where it's like, I'm going to fucking win this thing. And then I had to leave for a job every time. So I'd have to back out as I made my way through it. But I tried to describe that to somebody the other day. It's like, you don't realize that some of these bigger comedy clubs, you can think you're going in there for some boring night of just working out jokes, and in walks somebody that you, some big name comedian. You're like, what the fuck? And then it's like, now you get to sit 10 feet from them and listen to them do new, I don't know. It's awesome.
Some of those guys are fucking assholes, though.
They are. Oh, my God.
Because they just make it all about themselves. They don't even think about when they were struggling comedians. Because here's a prime example. When I first moved to L.A., I got on the New Face. It was called the New Faces. Mm-hmm. And it was at the Improv, and that was a dream come true. I'm like, I'm going to be at the Improv, with that famous brick wall behind me. This is amazing. I couldn't have been more excited.
I bet.
Invited all my friends that I'd only lived in LA for about a year, so I didn't have a whole lot of friends, but about 10, 12 people came to see me. And then Damon Wayans showed up, and I was excited. I was like, because I loved In Living Color. I loved the Wayans brothers, and I liked Damon Wayans a lot. And I was like, this is fucking awesome. Damon Wayans. I'm going to get to see Damon Wayans perform. No, he just was, he was like going through a divorce at the time. He was pissed off at his wife. He got up and he just ranted and fucking raved. And he had no jokes. He was just kind of being a dick and meandering on stage and got the entire New Faces show canceled because he went like almost an hour.
I've heard a lot of big comedians do that.
And even then I was like, oh, he's a big star. You know, I was excited for people. He popped in. And then a month later I got booked for the New Faces show again. And I'm excited. And then Damon Wayans shows up again, does the exact same thing. The entire New Faces show is canceled. And then a month later, I got booked on New Faces. Damon Wayans shows up again, does the same thing again, cancels the entire New Faces for all these young, hopeful comedians. And I'm like, motherfucker, some of us don't have an older brother that opened all these doors for us, you piece of shit. I was a fan of yous. Now I will hate you for the rest of my life. 20 years from now, I'll be on a fucking podcast in my kitchen and I'll fucking talk shit about you, you piece of shit. That's what pisses me off, because I get it. Yeah, you're a celebrity. You should be able, and if you want to, you know, you have some legitimate comedy you want to try out, come in and do 15, 20 minutes. Don't like ruin the show for all these other young comedians coming up. You know, like get their stuff canceled.
Yeah.
Just because you're that oblivious. Like,
I don't understand it. I never do. I mean, it sounds like you're living like a Wayne's Brothers Groundhog's Day.
I finally went up. I saw Bud Freeman, and I had 12 friends there, you know.
Yeah.
And I went up to him and I said, I was supposed to be on the New Faces show, got canceled because Damon Wayans showed up again.
Mm-hmm.
I said, I still have 12 friends here. Would I be able to go up? And he's like, yeah, okay. But you know Bud Freeman is. So
didn't he book?
He created the improv. He started it.
Okay, yeah.
In New York and then brought it to L.A.
There you go. That's why I was thinking it was New York.
Big,
okay.
big comedy name. And intimidating to talk to. So like I had to like get the nerve up. And he's like, sure. So I went up to the door person that you have to go through to get into the club. And I said, I just talked to Bud. And he said, since I have 12 friends here, I could go ahead and get up. The guy's like, Bud said that? I'm like, yes, he's right there. I mean, like, why would I make it up with him standing right there?
Right.
So Bud said, yeah, go ahead. Let him in. You know, so about 1 in the morning, I got up in front of my 12 friends that were left there. And I did the improv for the first time.
How did it go?
I know, okay. You know, the friends were supportive. I mean, it was probably my friends and two other people.
Right.
Like two other audience members. But it was still, that was my first time doing it, so I was happy, and there were no crickets, so that was good. My friends were supportive, you know.
That 1 a.m. spot, I would
that
think
sweet
would be
1 a.m. spot
would be hard just to open. You know, it's like the 8 p.m. spot or whatever. You know, that's what I was asking, how hard that would be or how that went.
Then I did the improv. They would do showcases there and different shows there, and every time I ever did the improv, I always did well when there was a big audience. I always get excited when there's a big audience. I get more nervous when there's like, you know, 12 or smaller.
Right.
Because I know with a bigger audience, there's going to be more energy and there's going to be more, the percentage of people that enjoy what I do is going to be higher. And that's contagious, you know?
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, for sure. Because
when it's like 8 people, they're more self-conscious. They're kind of like, I want to laugh at that, but am I the only one? And they're looking around, you know?
Yep. Or like no one ever wants to like burst out laughing in a quiet room.
Right.
When you say contagious like that, I used to see how far I could push the limits when I would DJ on how much shit I can get people to clap at.
Yeah.
Because I would get so bored DJing back to back to back all the time that, you know, I'd just be something stupid like, hey, let's give them a round of applause. You know, and they'd clap. And I was like, and let's give the sponsors a round of applause. Let's give the guy, you know, just keep, and they would fucking keep clapping because if one person clapped, there was, you know, 200 people in there, they would all clap. But I think two, maybe get your thoughts on this. If you play to a larger room, like if you're playing, say, 150 people as opposed to 10, I think that since you just obviously a numbers game, maybe your first joke, half might be into that, and then your second joke, the other half might be into that. So you get this constant laughter,
right?
As opposed to like a room of 10 where they might hit with one person out of 10 and it's just silence because you can't hear that person laugh.
Yeah, strength in numbers.
Exactly. That's interesting. So what was it like back then when you would go to do the open mic scene in LA? I mean, did you just walk in and sign up, or what was it like?
Yeah, a lot of places. Well, the Comedy Store has always done the same thing. They do like it's called Comedy Potluck when it's like the luck of the draw, really. Like they put everybody. You call. You used to be. I don't know how it is now because it's been a long time. But you used to call on. They did it on Sundays. You would call and they would put your name on a list. And then they would randomly draw names from that list to see who get to perform at the open mic that night.
Like, interesting.
And the Laugh Factory did the most soul-crushing open mic there was. because I guess they've changed it now, but it used to be where if you wanted to secure your spot, they only took 20 people. It was every Tuesday. Mm-hmm. The show started like, it was like from 7 to 8 where they did like just the open mic where every comic, all 20 did like 30 minutes.
Right.
And you would have to go there at like 5:30, 6 in the morning. And there would be like somebody would make, you'd have to make the list yourself, like 1 through 20. And then you stand in line at where you were going to be going. Because if you left, if you signed that list and left, someone would just take your spot. So you had to kind of like stay there on the street, on Sunset Boulevard, breathing in car exhaust, sitting in front of the Laugh Factory like a homeless person until 6 o'clock when you finally got your spot secured and you could sign in and maybe go get something to eat or maybe go grab a shower before the show, maybe. If you didn't, I didn't live too far away from the Laugh Factory. I couldn't, I just had to go do it.
Right. So you would get there at 6 a.m. Mm-hmm. and have to wait till 6 p.m.?
Wait 12 hours.
Jesus.
You'd make friends in the line and you'd say, can you hold my spot? I'm going to go grab lunch. Or you would you'd grab lunch for other people or whatever.
Wow.
Yeah, but it was, yeah. And I did it 5 times because Jamie Masato, who's the guy who owns the Laugh Factory, he's there once a month and he watches you. And that seems like a good thing. He watches you and that maybe that helped me get regular spots here at the Laugh Factory. Or he'll give me a shot. The guy's an egomaniacal piece of shit. Everyone like...
That was my next question.
He does, he does everything in a self-serving way. Like, right. I probably shouldn't say this because now we have... but I'm not working the Laugh Factory, so... He would talk to all the open micers afterwards, and he would sit on like this upstairs under this big bright light, like over his head, like
right.
And he'd sit down, and he would give you notes, and they were always terrible notes. Like it was because he's a failed stand-up comedian. He's a successful businessman, so right. If you want to tell me how to run a comedy club, I'm all ears. Mm-hmm. But you can't tell me how to write jokes because you failed at that.
Right. I mean, that's kind of a fine line, though, to give notes to a comedian because everyone's a different style. I mean, if one person gives 8 different comedians notes, I mean, that one person, he only has one style that he's going to think you should be doing it like this. I don't know. That seems kind of...
He tried to pigeonhole people, right. So you're this one thing. Oh, you're Jewish, then you should do more Jewish jokes. Oh, you're black, you should do more black jokes. Oh, you're...
I gotcha.
Oh, you were a paperboy as a kid. You should be the paperboy comic. You ride your bike on stage. You throw the jokes to the audience. That's just an exaggeration.
Is that what he sounds like?
Yeah.
Okay, that's why his name sounded familiar. Because I've heard him on a bunch of comedian podcasts, and they say the same thing.
Yeah.
And they always like circle the point on who it is, and then they start doing that impression, and they say his name, and they all say the exact same thing you did. It's like, basically... I don't fucking care what you have for notes for me. And now that you say the specific...
One of my first openers, my opening joke, it's dated pretty much now, but it was my first joke. I would just come out like very egotistical. Like, I'm like, hey, you guys are very lucky because you get to see me.
Right.
I love me. Me. Do, re, me. I wish I was a chick so I could score me.
Right.
And then I would just go, so I'm single. And then I would go into my regular material.
Mm-hmm.
And he pulled me up. I was talking to him after that. He goes, "You know Al Lubel?" I'm like, "Yeah, I love Al Lubel. You're very similar to Al Lubel. You cannot do this." I was like, Al Lubel's whole act is his ego.
Right.
He sings about how he loves himself. He's Al Lubel. His name was Lou. Would be Lulu Bell. Like, and I'd seen it, but it was nothing. He doesn't have a patent on fake ego, ironic humor.
Right. Right.
But his note was me that I couldn't do that because Al Lubel already does that.
See, I just don't get it. I don't understand it.
And then, but I prepared a different 3 minutes every time, so he would see a different 3 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
And I did good every single time. And every single time he would say, come back 4 weeks. Come back 4 weeks. After 5 times of that, I'm like, I'm not coming back and sitting on the sidewalk outside the Laugh Factory for 12 hours in the hot sun so you can tell me to come back 4 weeks.
Right.
You don't give a shit. You're not, trying to discover people.
See, I've always, I've seen quick shots, and I can't even remember what, but of that line, and I've heard some stories, you got to stand in line and all this, and I never understood what it was until now, so that makes sense, but how the...
You know who was one of the guys I waited in line with all day long, and I wanted to punch him? Dr. Ken Jeong.
Really?
He's the nicest guy you'll ever meet in the world. But he's a successful doctor. He was a successful doctor at that time.
Yeah.
And so he was like so like bubbly and happy and like bouncy. I'm like, mother, this is all I have.
Right.
You're a doctor. You're making six figures. Of course you're happy and bubbly. This is your hobby that you're just, you know.
Yeah, you're bored, so yeah. You're going to come do comedy. Yeah. That worked out.
He's a funny guy and stuff, but it's just like my own bitterness is like, fuck you, Dr. Ken. And then you make it, you piece of shit.
Right.
Just my own bitterness, you know. I think the guy's hilarious, but
well, that was my question: was if you got to sit out there like you moved there specifically for acting, but at that point you turned to comedy. Mm-hmm. How do you even?
Actually, I don't think it was. I think it was a showcase for like Aspen or something that I saw Dr. Ken at. I don't think it was the open mic thing because I don't think a doctor could do that.
Right.
Just stand on this Laugh Factory for 12 hours.
But I mean, how do you survive? How do you work?
I would just take the day off.
Your whole day is shot.
And then pick up the extra shifts to kind of try to make some of that money back.
Jesus. I mean, people don't understand like the differences in starting in comedy as opposed to starting in a band.
Yeah.
It's so difficult. And especially like that LA ain't cheap.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, it's not like you cannot not work. You know what I mean? That's quite a story.
Yeah. I was just pretty much waiting tables. Well, you know, that's what I did in Lincoln when I was going to college. So that's kind of what I knew. And
right.
So I was doing that a lot when I wasn't. You know, actually, I couldn't do comedy as much as I wanted to because I had to work to pay my rent. You know.
Right. How did you? What influences your writing now, and has it changed since then?
Yeah, I think it's changed. Not that much. Just the way I write has changed.
You probably found yourself.
I write more on stage than I used to. I used to write everything down, like every pause, every nuance, everything. I wrote it down, like in a notepad. I have notepads filled. And now what I do is I'll bring my phone on stage, and I have a recording app on the phone, and I'll have an idea, you know, like a basic idea of what new idea that I want to work out, and I'll do jokes that I know work. And then in between those jokes, I'll try out the new stuff. That way, if it's not really going anywhere, I can go back to the tried and true stuff I know works.
Right.
And I record that, and then I'll listen to it later and then try to trim the fat off of it and come up with some bits that way.
That makes sense. Completely.
But it's also because of technology now. I mean, I guess you could have taken one of those little tape recorders with you on stage, but I had one of those for a while, and I would lose it or forget it, and like. But you always have your phone on you, so it's much more convenient that way.
Exactly. That I have to do that with the podcast. Mm-hmm. I listen to these over and over and over. You know, it's like some of the ones that are like three and a half hours. I've listened to them 10, 20 fucking times because I constantly am kind of wondering, what am I doing wrong? What could I be doing better? I say like way too much.
Yeah,
way too much. And like just right there. So,
he said it right after. And like
some people, when they go to do a thought, usually their instinct is to say mine is I pause. So my problem is that sometimes when I think about my next thought, it's such a long pause.
Dead air.
So I got to trim all that shit down before I put it out. And people have asked me, why don't you do a setup similar to on Stitcher, which is a company that Amazon bought, which is where you could watch a live podcast. That's where like people are constantly watching professional video game players play all day. I guess that's a thing now with kids. But my problem is that there's a lot of dead time in podcasting, and I feel like it would be very boring to actually watch it.
Yeah.
I don't know how, like the top ones, like Joe Rogan Experience.
I always watch the highlights of it, you know what I mean?
Right.
Like the Joe Rogan ones. Mm-hmm. Like, I've never sat down and watched from beginning to end live video of his podcast.
Right.
I watch like the highlights and the clips that they come out with, you know? I love his podcast, but.
Yeah, it's great. I just don't know how they can consistently keep talking without any breaks. And there is a lot of dead space, and then it's getting weird now with a video, which is one thing that's kind of steering me away, is that on YouTube they're hardcore copyright now. So like if Rogan plays a video like they used to, they would play a video and the audio, YouTube will automatically find it and kick the episode off of YouTube. So like the other day there was a guy who I think he's like an archaeologist or something, fossils type person. They watched a video on YouTube. Well, you couldn't hear the sound. they watched it for like 25 fucking minutes. So all I'm hearing is him responding to what the guy's saying. But I can't hear what the guy's saying because they're going to get kicked off YouTube.
Right.
Yeah, I just kept skipping forward. I mean, like, this 20-minute segment is making me lose interest.
They weren't even doing a play-by-play of what...
They had, like, a guy who puts out videos who believes, like, the Earth is flat and, you know, dinosaurs didn't exist and all that stuff. So he's, like, going on this 30-minute rant. Well, the guy who is this big-time archaeologist is listening to it and saying, you know, that's like this because of this. And it's like, well, he's making good points, but it would make a lot more sense if I could hear what this fucking guy is saying, right. You know? So, I don't know. Stitcher's cool. I guess the thing with kids now, like, little kids are into videos of kids opening up these eggs, and there's toys inside of it.
Yeah.
And they do, like, a review on the toy. And kids watch these all the time, all these little kids in my
life. Is it like some mail-in service? They mail you, you don't know what it's like, a grab bag, you don't know what you're going to get?
I'm not really sure. I'm not sure why they come out of an egg. But these kids are just watching toy reviews. Or like a couple years above that, there's kids who just watch people play video games all day. So now we're at a point where, you know, when I was a kid, my parents complained that we played video games all day. Now parents are complaining that their kids are watching kids play video games all day. I don't know when it stops. It's going to be like when you have a mirror in front of you and a mirror behind, yeah. And you can see like never-ending images of yourself. That's what it's going to be. I'm watching a guy play video games.
Right. I don't know how you could watch somebody play video games. If the graphics are good, maybe 5 minutes.
Yeah. Yeah. I don't know.
Otherwise, it's always repetitive. You know, oh, I died. I got to start over.
Exactly. Oh, okay, yeah. I couldn't even watch it because I would get sick because I can't handle the motion if I don't know the direction they're going.
Yeah.
As opposed to when I do it, you know, the thought is there before the movement, so I know which way I'm going to move. So it's like my brain's ready for it. I watch somebody play like a first person shooter game and I'll just throw up. It makes me sick. When you did the open mics in LA, did you mainly just stay in LA for that?
Yeah.
I mean, how long did you run that circuit before you started, I guess, doing a feature?
At least 10 years. Yeah. Maybe slightly more. Let's see, 95. No, let's see. I think it was about 2002. I was talking about where there was an agent that I sent him that tape, and he liked me.
Had you been sending out tapes prior to that?
I'd sent out a few tapes, but other ones. This was one of the ones at the time I was the most proud of.
Right.
And luckily, he liked it a lot, so I sent that to him, and he liked me. He told me, he said, I have too many clients as it is, but I do like you, so I'd like to help you get some work when I can.
Interesting.
So he would throw me feature work. He got my first feature job, big feature job, was in Vegas, doing a week at the Riviera in Vegas. Rest in peace, Riv. And that was awesome. My whole family came out for that, and it was great. It was like, he was like, it's only $1,000, you know. I'm like
yeah,
I'll take it. You know, I don't make $1,000 waiting tables in a week.
Exactly. Doing comedy in Vegas for $1,000, sure.
Mm-hmm.
Why not? Especially that early in the game.
Yeah, and then he got me Catch a Rising Star in Reno and a few other random places around. And then at one point, he just got too busy for me.
Right.
He switched over to an even bigger agency and just didn't have the time for him. He was a super nice guy, but I kind of fell through the cracks there, unfortunately. But I did get the experience. Tom Rhodes, that's how I met Tom Rhodes, was
nice
working with him. Tom Rhodes was one of his clients at the time, and I got to feature for him. We became good buddies because we both like a lot of the same music. We're both music junkies, and we went and saw like Willie Nelson and Ryan Adams and Nico Case at the Hollywood Bowl. That was awesome.
Nice.
Yeah.
How was your experience on To Catch a Rising Star?
It was good. It was in Reno.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it was fun.
What was the process
that
like?
Was the first. That was actually a big eye-opener for me, though, because that was another weeks-long gig, and I was opening for this great comic named Billy Garen. And Billy Garen is kind of old school, like very audience-pleasing, does a lot of characters. Halfway through the run, I'm kind of bored of my act, so this is, you know, kind of like where I started, you know, experimenting and throwing in new material I had. And
right.
And at the time, Jennifer Lopez was the biggest. She had like so this was like early 2000s. So like she had just, you know, had her album out, you know, Jenny from the Block, all that bullshit, fake crap, because she's the most shallow person ever. They had a writer on the smokinggun.com, had one of her artist writers that got released, and it was right after 9/11.
Mm-hmm.
it was a bunch of musicians that got together and the same Marvin Gaye's What's Going On, and they were filming a music video, and all the proceeds from that song were to go to 9/11 victims and their families and African AIDS relief. And the people working on it were totally couldn't believe the list of demands that Jennifer Lopez sent over that she had to have for this charity video shoot. Like everything, like she had to have the biggest trailer, everything in the trailer had to be white, the couch had to be white, she had to have all these certain CDs, she had to have room temperature water. And I was reading that and I said, you know, people let her get away with it because she's a celebrity. They go, right. They just write it off as her being a diva. They're like, oh, well, she's a diva. You know, she's a diva. And I said, I think people just say diva because it sounds better than cunt.
Yeah.
And I said that at Catch a Rising Star. And the next day, I get a phone call from the headquarters of Catch a Rising Star to say that someone complained that I was too angry and I said cunt too much. Which is totally disingenuous. I said it once. Maybe that was too much for them. But that right. also implies that I'm just going cunty cunt, 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 right. cunty cunt, cunt. You know? So that was an eye-opener because I had done really well. And I still did well that night, too. Just one person didn't like it.
Mm-hmm.
But then I get a phone call because that one person like called them. But like, if someone would have called them and said that Brad Stewart was wonderful, we really loved him, they wouldn't call me and say, hey, someone just really gave you a really good compliment. Keep up the good work. They wouldn't do that. They wouldn't even care. You know what I mean? That was a big eye-opener for me. Like, oh, wow. One person complains and that carries weight. You know, like
it's like back when people would
99% of the audience laughs, but 1% does it, and they're worried about that 1%.
Yeah, I mean, you know, the early late 90s, early 2000s, when all it took was like one person to write a letter to a show, and they're like, well, we can't do this anymore. It's like, who gives a fuck about that one person?
Right.
You had like a million people watching it. One person got mad, blow them off. Who cares? Especially now, because with any social media and just the internet in general, anybody can have a voice. So now it's like, and everyone's offended, and I just don't get it. I'm constantly walking around my arms out like, I don't understand what the problem is.
Mm-mm.
Can't we joke about race and sex and
everything?
All that? I don't.
I think nothing's off limits.
Exactly.
As long as it's funny.
Have you ever heard the, I know it's Jamie Foxx. You know, he was on in Living Color back in the day, and J-Lo was a dancer before she got big on there. Mm-hmm. And he's got this bit from a long time ago. He's like, I remember the days of in Living Color, you know, before the J-Lo, it was just, hey-ho.
Yeah.
He's like, and he said that, and that was when she was with Puff Daddy, and he got all pissed off about it. But it's, again, can't fucking take a joke. Right. I mean, that's a good fucking joke.
Yeah.
Diva. I fucking hate how everyone... people get away with being an asshole, and they always say that line of, well, that's just John, you know, that's just so-and-so. It's like, no, they're an asshole. Yeah. I mean, it doesn't matter who they are. I'm not going to get used to it because they're a douchebag, you know?
Yeah.
Do I act like a douchebag? Yeah. No. I mean, it just drives me nuts.
That's just who they are. Yep. They're just douchey.
Just let them go. So when you got an agent, what year was that? 2001?
And I actually didn't even get an agent. It was just an agent that was helping me out. I wasn't signed with them or anything.
Mm-mm. Gotcha.
They kind of call it, I guess they call it hip pocketing, where you don't really sign with them, but they kind of like help you and kind of steer you in the right direction or get you work. And that's what he did for me, but then he just got too busy for me. And so I've never had an agent, really.
When you realized that point had hit where he was too busy for you, what direction did you go?
I was running my own show in L.A., so it made me very happy. I did it like I do here every Sunday. It was a weekly show with another comic that's still in L.A., this guy named Joshua Padgett, who's really funny. And we did this weekly comedy show, and we'd have some of the best comedians that are some of the best ones now, too.
Like really?
Kyle Kinane, a good friend of mine. He was on it a lot. Matt Bronger, Rob Delaney.
Oh, my God.
Greg Fitzsimmons would stop in.
Fitzsimmons, he's fucking hilarious.
Tom Rhodes used to do it every once in a while. All these people, and then we'd have like six people there, you know.
That's crazy. I mean, like, it's crazy to hear that and how big they are.
I remember on MySpace, I messaged Patton Oswalt to see if he wanted to do it. He messaged me back, and he was like, I'm working on this Disney juggernaut right now, but I really like that room. I might try to do it sometime.
Oh,
and it never worked out. He never was able to do it. But the Disney juggernaut was Ratatouille. That's what he was talking about that he was working on.
Interesting. I love his fucking stand-up.
He's one of the best.
And I love him on King of Queens. Plays just that soft nerd or whatever. Yeah. Oh my God, I love that show so much. I can say every line.
He's awesome. I remember I was thinking, I kind of saw the birth of the alternative scene. There used to be a show called, and they still, I think they still do it. It's called Uncabaret, And they used to do it at this place called Luna Park, which was a really awesome venue for comedy. They had this basement, real intimate basement. Mm-hmm. And it was just like actors and comedians, humorous actors that would just come in and tell, you know, stories.
Right.
Like alternative comedy started out as. But still, it was hilarious. It was awesome. I remember Patton Oswalt came on. He was a writer for Mad TV at the time. Nobody knew who he was. Mm-hmm. And he had a joke. He goes, "Is it bad when you call alcohol pain go bye-bye juice?" And he also said, "I like my women like I like my coffee, tied up in a bag and thrown in the back of a donkey by Juan Valdez."
I fucking love
that. That was like two of his early jokes that I remembered. Kathy Griffin would do it. It was right when Titanic came out. Mm-hmm. And she was like lip-syncing to Celine Dion.
Yeah.
And literally just pulled her shirt off, pulled her bra off, topless, and like fell to her knees, like singing with her boobs hanging out. It's just, "I'm sorry, I just got really, you know, when you're listening to Celine, clothes are just bullshit."
How easy or hard was that to get your own show out there? Because I just can only imagine with how many comedians are there.
There's so many venues, so many different little bars, little you know, coffee houses. It's not that hard if you just have to take the initiative to do it.
I didn't think about that.
It's hard to keep it running because it's hard to get people to come to anything. Especially in LA when they're like, you know, they can see big name comics all the time.
Right.
For little to no money, you know?
That's true. That's a good point.
When a lot of the comics that I was having on my show weren't big at the time, you know, mm-hmm. like I ran that show from 2005 till 2008. And I think Kyle Kinane didn't really blow up until about 2010, 2011.
Yeah, for sure.
And that was Matt Bronger.
Mm-hmm.
TJ Miller was supposed to do it once and didn't. That was kind of bummed me out. Well, TJ Miller is hilarious. And he
fucking
did. I wasn't familiar with him. He just was friends with Kyle Kinane because they both did comedy in Chicago together for a while. And so I met him through Kyle. And even at this, like, TJ Miller had just done amazing at Aspen Comedy Festival. Like, he was the most buzzed about comedian. Everybody was like all over him. And he got to L.A. and he was like, "It's really hard to get on shows in L.A. And I said, "Well, I run a show. You want to do my show?" He's like, "That'd be great." And he was doing a show at the – so I announced it on MySpace that mm-hmm. him and Kyle were on the show. And then he was doing a show at the UCB, and that ran a little long, and he just didn't come to my show. And there was like four agents there, these young agents. They were there just to see T.J. Miller. They're like, "Where's T.J. Miller?" I'm like, "I don't think he's going to make it, actually." "Well, said it was." I said, "You know, well, sometimes things change, and God fucking forbid you see another comic that you might like here.
Right.
You're here. Why not watch other comedians?"
Exactly. Like, that's what I was thinking.
Yeah. What's with the tunnel vision? Like, Kyle Kinane was on that show. Like, you know, they could have saw Kyle Kinane and signed him at that time, you know?
Yep. Ridiculous. What ended that show for you?
Just the lack of people coming. It was just too hard to keep going.
Right.
They did music shows there, too, And it just got to be too much. It wasn't successful enough to keep doing it. It's nice enough that the owner let us do it for as long as we did, but you know,
that's true.
He was a really intimidating guy because he just seemed like he was dead inside. He just was very dry and okay. All right, you know,
go up there and do your funny thing.
"Well, you guys really aren't bringing a whole lot of people. It's been 3 years." Yeah, okay. I guess we'll move on. Also, they called the show No Name Comics. Because like my whole thing was like, you know, even at that time, Patton Oswalt was still an acclaimed comedian. Mm-hmm. You know, in 2005, people already loved him. But I was like, my whole point was like, but my mom doesn't know who he is. Like, there's a lot of so many great comedians that are really no names. Like, people don't know their names.
Mm-hmm.
That was the point of naming the show ironically, but people didn't really get it. So it's
right. Smudge, Jake Brandt. He had told me, "Hey, I'm going to keep that nickname going, Smudge. You're fucked." He had told me a story about with you and touring with Joan Rivers.
Mm-hmm.
When did that start?
In 2010.
How did that start?
That was just your typical, stereotypical, who you know type of situation.
Interesting.
I was dating a girl who was an agent at ICM. That was Joan's agency. She was a concert agent, so she booked stuff on the road for bands and comedians.
I gotcha.
And I was actually home in Nebraska, and she called me and said, "Joan Rivers is doing 3 dates in the Midwest in Kansas, Oklahoma, and what's the last one? Kansas, Oklahoma, and Missouri." And she goes, "And she needs an opening act. Send me over your clips so I can send them to her."
Mm-hmm.
So I had some clips, and I sent them to her, and which she forwarded over to Joan Rivers, and they liked me, so they hired me, and then we just ended up getting along really, really great. At the end of those three shows, that three-show run we did, Joan's assistant, Graham, who I became good friends with, too, because he's a really funny, cool guy.
Yeah.
And he was like, Joan wants your parents' address. I'm like, why? What did I do?
Right.
He's like, no, she just wants to send him a note about how great you were, and she's going to send your mom some of her QVC jewelry. And she did.
That's pretty sweet. What was it like, I mean, being around her? I mean,
it was awesome.
What was she like? And she's so fucking funny.
She was real as they get, and nice, and thoughtful, and cool. That she had no problem. She, you know, when she would be getting her hair and makeup done, she had no problem with me sitting next to her in her dressing room and picking her brain for like 20, 30 minutes and just talking about comedy and different things. And she couldn't have been nicer. She was awesome. The very first time I opened for her, I was scared shitless because it's Joan Rivers.
Right.
You know, you don't know how she's going to be. What if she's, you know, like, because her persona is so, like, cutting.
But yeah.
She's just sharp. She was sharp as hell. Whatever that accident that happened with, you know, she'd still be doing stand-up right now, I think.
Oh, yeah. That's what I had mentioned to Smudge was people only know her from the shows, like, with her daughter and
stuff. Fashion Police.
Yeah, Fashion Police. But people do not, like, you watch some of her stand-up, it is just bang, bang, bang. I mean, it's just nonstop laughter.
Plus, there's so many phrases that she coined that people don't even realize. More chins in a Chinese phone book, that's Jones. She wrote that, first person to write that. I think she wrote it about Elizabeth Taylor.
I can't imagine how hard it would have been trying to become a female or trying to become a comic as a female when she started.
Oh, yeah. She said she did a show in New York and Jack Lemmon walked out because he didn't think women should talk like that.
Really?
Yeah. I'm like, oh, you're going to ruin Jack Lemmon for me. But yeah, people didn't like her because she was speaking her mind. She did like thinly veiled abortion jokes in the 70s, in the late 60s, early 70s. Like, that isn't, I mean, an abortion joke will get people riled up and mad at you now in 2016.
Yeah, that's what I was just thinking. I can't imagine how bad that would have been then.
Yeah.
Especially because, I mean, people were starting to open up then about just everything, you know, language and sexuality and you name it, but nothing like it is now.
Yeah.
So if you push the limits back then, which I guess we'll probably look at that 2 decades from now and think we were, you know, so cutting edge on how everyone talks and acts. And
I was guilty like everybody else too about Joan, where I just, you know, I kind of knew her from her later work. I remember her hosting The Tonight Show when I was a kid, but, you know, I would never really, my parents never really let me stay up late enough to watch The Tonight Show.
Right.
But I remember Dot Matrix and Spaceballs, of course. But I was not familiar with her actual stand-up until I started working with her, and then I was just in awe of her. And then I ran out and I went on Amazon after those first 3 shows we did together, and I bought her first book called Inner Talking, which is a must-read for anybody that likes Joan Rivers or likes stand-up comedy. It's amazing. It's the most concise thing about her life story, that her very first book called Inner Talking.
Interesting.
She always wanted to be an actress. We had kind of the same background, you know? Like, I wanted to be an actress. She wanted to be an actress. And she was in New York, and she would see comedians like Dom DeLuise, and they would all go to the same cafe, and found out, like, you know, he was doing comedy in the weekends and making like enough money to feed himself. And she's like, "Well, I'm going to try that." And so that's how she started doing it. Her original name was like Pepper something. She was going by Pepper something.
Have you always gone by
My real name? Yeah.
Interesting.
I think Brad Stewart sounds awesome.
Yeah, actually.
And so some people think I'm saying Rod Stewart, but.
It is, because I was saying it this morning. Even when I just have conversations, my girlfriend was just giving me shit about this before I came over here. I always open it up with a really good intro to kind of like I walked in the kitchen the other night and I was like, "So you're a girl, right?" So she's like, "Yes." Like, you know, and that's just how I fucking talk. And sometimes I forget that I do it like that.
So you have a boob and a vagina, right?
Correct.
No, I have boobs and a vagina. Oh, yeah. Sorry. Thanks for correcting me.
But I always enjoy good intros. And I was like walking around the house this morning being like, "Ladies and gentlemen, Brad Stewart." Like, you just have a really good introduction name. Some people's names don't flow that good, but I just don't have a life, really. I'm walking around saying your name. That's how exciting my day is.
I like my name better than I like myself. So.
Yeah.
But Joan used to introduce me herself, too, from off to the side of the stage. You couldn't see her, but you know her voice when you hear it. And that's, I really appreciated that because it would legitimize me. You know, people would know that I was Joan approved. She also wouldn't start a show until everybody was in their seats for me. Like, I was part of it. It was our show. She treated it like our show. Like, that was, like, I couldn't get over that. But she always had the same introduction. She did it for all. I was the only person she used. She just used me quite a bit. Like, I think I was, probably over a 3-year period, I worked with her about 50 times or more. But she used the same joke for every opening act, which is a funny joke. She'd say, please welcome the best opening act in his price range. Except where the reason I moved back to Nebraska was because my dad had ALS, Lou Gehrig's disease, and that's what brought me back home because I wanted to be with him because I knew that's terminal illness. You know, you only live 3 to 5 years after diagnosis. So I moved back to be with him, and I was still open for her. And then he passed away, and about a month after that, I was opening for Joan. And she's, you know, it's the only time she changed that, where she goes, please welcome to the stage Dean Stewart's son, Brad Stewart.
That's pretty fucking cool.
So I'm getting ready to go on stage, like, in eyes are watering up.
Trying to keep that emotion down.
Look over and go, Joan, you bitch.
Yeah.
You got to be funny now. You have to be so nice. God.
I guess when I hear those stories, that makes me, I guess her character is described to me as someone who hasn't forgotten where she came from.
Never.
She's not forgetting.
Her career was up and down, up and down.
Oh, that's a good
point. Never forgot what it was like to be down. And not only that, she always thought that could happen tomorrow. So she never stopped working. I mean, like, she worked in her late 70s. She worked harder than most 30-year-olds. I mean, like, hopping on planes, flying from both coasts. You know, flying to do a live show and then flying to tape a QVC thing and then flying to tape her reality show and then Fashion Police. And it was just, she was amazing.
Some people, I feel like, even when they're that age, if they stop, they'll die.
You're like a shark. If they stop swimming, they'll die.
Exactly. Yeah. I mean, I see it in the industry. For work, I'm a welding inspector. Mm-hmm. And I see it a lot of times with welders. You know, they work 6-10s their whole life, or that's all they've ever known. And then they retire, and then it's just like, well, I'm just not doing anything now. And then it's not 3-5 years later, they're dead. Because they just don't. It's like they, I don't know. Your analogy there is.
Routine keeps people going. It's the routine of life, you know what I mean? And when that routine gets changed.
Sometimes, you know, even for people who, like my dad, even when he retires in whatever, he keeps telling me 10 years, we'll see. When he retires in 10 years, he's going to keep working. My dad's like, he's the type of guy who has always had the expression, if I didn't have to sleep, I could get another job. Mm-hmm. So I just don't see him stop working, but I feel like if he has a job of any type, he gives him something to wake up for. Mm-hmm. So that's kind of what keeps him going. But I feel like if he just stopped
working. That's
how
my dad was, too, until his diagnosis, until he couldn't, you know, move. But he was a high school teacher, and then he became a principal, and then he became a superintendent, and that's what he was when I was in school. He was my school superintendent. And then he retired and then moved to Lincoln, retired from Weeping Water, and then moved to Lincoln and immediately became a superintendent of the Legacy, a nursing home here in Lincoln. Like, he was
really?
A superintendent there for a while. And then left there, and then he was substitute teaching to fill the time, and then he also started driving the train at the children's zoo here. You know,
nice.
He couldn't sit still. You know,
what exactly happens to the body when they get ALS?
It just starts slowly giving up. I mean, you can't. It's a motor neuron thing, so your brain stops sending signals. You know, just almost like if your nose itches, you can't lift your hand up to scratch it. You know, you can't.
Interesting.
And you eventually have to have a feeding tube and you lose the ability to speak. And luckily, he actually, I mean, if you can call it lucky, but, you know, he passed away before he lost his ability to speak, which is from when he was finally diagnosed. And it's a type of disease, too, that they just eliminate everything else until that's the last thing on the table. And they're like, okay, so you have ALS.
I gotcha.
So from the actual final diagnosis to when he died was about exactly 3 years.
Wow. That's quick.
But he never lost the ability to speak, which I thought was a blessing because he loved to visit with people. He liked people a lot, and he liked talking to people. So he never lost that ability. And he was a great. He was as positive as a person could be. I mean, he'd say, "I hate this life," and I'm like, "Of course you do," you know. But he was still positive. He still wanted to go to Husker games if he could. Mm-hmm. He wanted the Husker baseball games.
What was the signs?
Usually it starts in people's lower half. Usually starts in people's legs, but his started like in his diaphragm.
Huh.
And he just started. He started hunching over, and he couldn't straighten his back. And we're like, "What? That's weird. What is that?
Right.
What's going on there?"
Interesting.
Someone's here.
Before I had this laptop, I had like a desktop iMac, a really big screen, because I'm fucking blind. I've had glaucoma my whole life. I can't see shit. So I should be driving automobiles. But the hard drive crashed, and I had like two episodes that were recorded, but I hadn't edited them down. And when I took it in to save the hard drive, they said, "There's nothing we can do. It's just dead." And usually I have a little recorder that I back up each episode with, and that's what actually saved them. They kind of sound like shit, but I think one of them was with my younger brother, who is hardcore on debt payoff, things like that. So I really wanted to get that one on there. The other one we actually had to redo, which is with a guy who owns Digital Sky here in town. I really learned a lot of lessons from that, of having that crash and having it not record, which is why I had to buy the backup recorder. And I thought when I first tested it, I was like, "Yeah, this sounds good." Until you actually have to edit a podcast with it, and it only like records in two monos, so you only hear like one on one ear and one on the other ear, and it annoys the shit out of me.
Yeah,
because I like to hear it in stereo.
Right,
but. Yeah, a lot of lessons learned on that. That's why I just said, fuck it, I'm spending the money and just buying like some legit equipment. And I've always been a audio nerd. I love it. And even like I went to church with my girlfriend the other day up here, and it was like one of those churches where it's like a concert. And I don't even know what they said the whole time, because the whole hour I'm like, well, I would set the room up a lot different than this, because, you know, every time somebody would go out the fucking door, the lights would come, like the sunlight would come in, and it would just like break the mood.
Yeah.
And then it just, they were in like a gym, so the sound is bouncing off concrete everywhere. I mean, it was, it's just church, I guess, but I still, the little things like that annoy the fuck out of me. But I just stared up at all the lights and the audio equipment. They got a legit setup for church.
Concerts have been ruined for you. If they don't sound pristine, you're like, this.
Boo!
Yeah.
Well, you don't like my act? No, I don't like your equipment. Yeah.
No, listen, but in comedy, you wouldn't believe how many times like the microphone is not working right. Or it's like, you guys have bands here, right? Like, you have like 5-piece bands come and play. I just need this one thing to work. That's all. Like, this one fucking thing to work. That's it.
That's like, when I was in a competition, comedy competition in Kansas City, I was so nervous that I had made it to the next round. And so when I went up, like 30 seconds in, I stepped on the cord and it ripped it out of the bottom of the mic.
Yeah.
So then I got to fucking try and fit, you know, get this thing back plugged back in.
Oh, your hands are shaking?
Oh, yeah. Just a swamp ass instantly, you know, because everyone's just like... You weren't. You almost had us till you fucked up the mic, and it ruined the whole show. I mean, he could have brought out a big time name to save it, and they still would have been like, "Yep, you've lost our attention." At that point, they probably got more laughs.
It's happened to a lot of people.
Really?
Yeah, the thing falling out. Sometimes you don't even step on it; just kind of a loose connection. And you, as they're grabbing it out of the stand, it just kind of hooks it, and then immediately falls. Like, oh, the audience is always like, oh, and you just like, you know. You just like, I'm a professional comedian.
Yeah, I'm a professional. This is part of my act.
Yeah. I just break shit.
No, it's...
like my will to live.
It's like I was watching an old HBO special of Jamie Foxx the other day. And
his first stand-up special was hilarious.
Oh, my God.
That's what I'm speaking of. He's like the ho joke, because he would go, everybody say hey.
Yeah.
Ho. Hey ho. He'd point to a girl in the front.
That his... What made me nervous watching it the whole time is his cord's like 100 feet long. And he walks over it and through it and around it, and then you're just waiting like, oh, he's going to rip it out. Yeah. Like, oh, I'm freaking out. But
now they all use cordless mics.
Exactly.
Some people even use like the lapel mic where you can't even see it. They're just, which I don't know how I feel about that for stand-up comedy. It feels more like you're doing like an inspirational speech.
Yeah, I feel like that. Whether there's a wire or not, the mic is very iconic to stand-up comedy.
Me too.
Yeah, I don't know. That would see that would annoy the shit out of me. If I was at a comedy show and they came out like that, I'm like, I'd get like, what are we, a church? Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Like,
and a lot of comics will use the microphone to enhance bits, you know, like, you know.
Oh, yeah, exactly. That's what I brought up.
Or like, you know, you could lean into the microphone and...
Well, the episode I just put out, I brought up that special because that was like one of my favorite. That was like my first HBO special. And like when I was a kid, HBO was a fucking dream if you got to see HBO because we could never pay the extra money for it. So when I, you know, we got like some week free or something and it was that week was his special came out and it just, it really changed my life. Because it was just unbelievable. I'd never seen anybody work a crowd like that. He's got, like, he does it in a couple other stand-up ones, you know, but he'll be like, he talks about how people that he loved have changed, like OJ, you know, he's like from sugar to shit. Well, by the end of all these people, he has the entire crowd, when he says from sugar, they're all to shit. I mean, they're so... just leaning on the next word he's going to say. And they probably didn't... It's like he brainwashed them because it's not like he said, I need everybody to say this. They just started saying it.
Yeah.
It's like, how... Wait.
But Chris Rock, too, you know?
Oh, yeah.
It's like... Why? Because you never know.
Exactly.
Why? Because you never know.
They're so good. But the... What I brought up about Jamie Foxx's one was... I said, isn't it interesting how technology can change... something as simple as your stand-up bit.
Mm-hmm.
Because once that wire's gone, he uses the actual wire for, I guess, like physical comedy.
Right.
But with their with the new mic now, you know, he obviously is the type of guy, he updates his bits or his show to where that joke is probably never going to come back again.
Mm-hmm.
But if he tried to do it now, it wouldn't even be as funny because there's no wire.
Right.
So it's just... it's just one of those little things that interests me.
I do still see the wire and certain things. I think some comics just are used to that, you know. It just depends on what your preference is. Because I'll ask you, I'm sure, you know, do you want a cordless or what kind of microphone do you want to use if you're recording a special, you know?
Right.
But then Jamie Foxx, and then what is he doing, like Verizon ads now?
I think he's just bored now. Did the stand-up, did the acting, and he's like, yeah, I don't know.
I want an Oscar. Next logical step. Be a shill for fucking commercials. What the fuck? Like, there used to be shame in that. Like,
okay, yeah.
Like celebrities would go to Japan and get, because they would get, like, you know, like this insane amount of millions and millions of dollars. It was like, it's just too insane to turn down. But they were still ashamed of it. They still didn't want it to be seen.
Mm-hmm.
But now they just, who cares? Like Samuel Jackson, what's in your wallet? I know what's not in your wallet. I'm a fucking Capital One. Give it Black American Express, you sellout fuck.
No shit. What about. I've asked people this. I, it's the same process that you're talking about. Didn't it used to be if you were in movies and then you went and worked on, say, like a CBS show, your career was failing?
Oh, yeah. That's what they – that used to be. But now TV's consistently better than movies, really.
I just like how – I mean, they must be. I just like how are they paying these price tags on these expensive actors for these TV shows? They just must be just raking it in.
Yeah.
It's just unreal. But it's like I see all these big-name actors who would rather do TV shows now than a movie, and I'm like, I thought it was the opposite. I thought if you made it to movies,
you're on top. It used to be, but now TV is such good quality television shows now.
Yeah, that's true.
And with Netflix, with their original series and all that, I mean, like, yeah, I think more and more want to do it. Plus, it's, you know, it's better. It's more the quality of the work probably is what appeals to them. For the most part, I think.
I've heard that a lot about.
And it's a consistent job. Like a movie's like, you know, I mean, you're working for, you know, a month or so, but then you have to, then you're hunting around for your next job.
Right.
But if you're on a TV show, that's consistent work, consistent pay. That's just.
And then royalties.
Yeah.
Hopefully. Getting them Seinfeld checks.
Right.
Yeah, that's interesting to talk about, like, the movie in TV. That's an interesting life, the being an actor in a movie, because if you're not getting the big payday, just like you said, that month has got to just fly by in the little part that you have in a movie, you know, and then it's, okay, now where's my next paycheck? Yeah. Where's my next work? That'd be weird to try and live off those paychecks, because you don't really know.
A lot of people do it.
At least with a TV show, you would, you know, you kind of have like, yay, we got another season.
Mm-hmm.
So at least you know for this amount of time I got work. That's interesting.
Mm-hmm.
When you talk about coming back because your dad got ALS, when I read the information, you know, your bio and stuff like that, that was the question in my head, was how did he go to LA and then end up back in Nebraska? Because you're still killing it with comedy. I mean, like, I told you the other day on a message that I shared one of your events, and it, like, within a minute, I got a message from somebody on Facebook. Please tell me you're having him on the podcast.
Well, that's awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, and they said, because they had been somewhere where you had done a comedy show for them, and like, he just killed it. Yeah. Killed it.
That's awesome.
Yeah. And it's like, yeah. I was like, yeah, I'm trying to get him on here.
What show was that?
Yeah, exactly.
Because as a comedian, you don't ever feel like you're killing it. You feel like you're struggling the whole time, and right. nothing's working out. It's like, you know, it's part of that comedian mentality. It's like, but I am happier than I ever was in LA, though, doing comedy back home in Lincoln. I could still do the road. Mm-hmm. I mean, I don't do it as often as I like. Luckily, like, started about last year. I've been home for about 4 years now. And last Christmas, I started getting a lot of offers for holiday parties, which have been great, you know.
Like, I was going to say, how are those?
They're very, you know, but, you know, I temper my act for what my audience is, you know.
Right.
I just say, I can't swear, usually.
Yeah.
I might let something slip every once in a while.
But. See, that'd be my thing, is I could do it, but, like, even if I had to go on, like, a radio show and mm-hmm. someone, you know, they're like, hey, just so you know, you can't cuss, and people would be like, oh, yeah, that's bullshit. You know, it's like, they're always going to slip out.
Yeah. I mean, my ideal show is where I can just, there's no limit, and I can just say whatever I want to say, and the right. people are there to see me, and that's, you know. But I just like making people laugh. That's the whole reason I started doing this. So it's like, there's a lot of comedians that are like, that wasn't my audience. I'm like, well, then you didn't win them over. You didn't exactly. find, you didn't find common ground with them. That's on you. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? I mean, there are legitimately just shit audiences. Just nothing you can do. It doesn't matter. Like, I did that one time. There was this open mic here in Lincoln that doesn't even go on anymore. There was these comics, and they all still do comedy, though. They're all really funny young comics here in Lincoln. And they did this open mic, and then nobody usually came. And one night, a whole bunch of people came. And the guy running it called me, and he said, do you want to stop by the open mic? There's a bunch of people here. And I was like, sure. So I went, and everybody was great, except for this one woman that was right in the front row that was just chewing on gum, kind of looking around, like almost like rolling her eyes, like didn't want to be there. And that's the person the comics will focus on when you're on stage. It could be right. like, the entire room is laughing, and there's one woman in the front row just like. But then at the end, I was like outside having a cigarette after the show, and she walked up to me. She goes, hey, you're really funny. I like you. Thanks.
Wow.
I couldn't tell by your face.
Exactly. Thanks for expressing it in there in front of everybody. That's one thing I always compare, you know, if you're in a band and you have songs, not just cover songs, you can just get up and do them and it's done. But with comedy, you can tell the exact same routine back-to-back nights. One night might kill, and the next night some people might question why you're even doing comedy.
Right.
And it's just, it's hard because it's just the energy in the room. It just, are they there for comedy? Okay, mm-hmm. If they are, you're already a step up. Then after that, it's like, what's the room like? What are the people like?
Are they talking really loud? Are you going to have to, is there some one person being obnoxious and you have to address that? And like, you know.
Yep. Do you run into hecklers a lot?
Not that often.
Yeah.
Thank God, because, you know, I'm going to have a few things that I can say off the cuff,
right?
That aren't really off the cuff, but, you know, like I know there's been a couple times where, you know, there was a girl talking really loud, and I was like, were you talking? Oh, I'm sorry. Sorry to interrupt. I mean, they're paying me to be here, and I have a public address system, and I'm facing an audience, but it was your turn. I'm sorry. I didn't realize that. Go ahead. Usually, if the audience is already on your side, you don't even have to be that witty, you know?
Like, oh, yeah, for sure. I have been gone for quite a while with work, and I used to live in Georgia and all that because of my career. When I came back to Nebraska, I see what's happening with comedy right now, and I'm like, are you people fucking seeing what I'm seeing? Like, it's about to happen. It's building up. I mean, it used to be like all you could ever catch was like one open mic. You know, it's always Duffy's, which is great, but it's like, is there more? I mean, I got to go all the way to Omaha to the Funny Bone to catch somebody coming through town.
Yeah.
I mean, there's a lot of funny people around.
That's why I was kind of excited to stay.
Yeah.
Because I literally moved to LA 2 weeks after I turned 21, and I never had a fake ID, so I didn't really go out and see live music. Or there was a few. I was an improv group, and they would let me in, even though I wasn't 21, to do the show, and then I'd have to leave. We'd get like, you know, sometimes there'd be people there, and we'd all get like $10 each. Mm-hmm. We'd be like, yeah, I got paid to do this. It was awesome. But then I noticed there was a niche that needed filled. There was enough young talent in Nebraska that were doing comedy, were doing Duffy's on a regular basis, or going to Omaha and doing open mics there, that I thought, I want to stay here and see where this goes.
Yeah, I can just see it uprising.
I hope so.
It's there.
It's so many people are not aware. I mean, there's only so much I can do. I don't have any sort of marketing budget, really. I mean, we make a little bit of money on the shows, and that goes right back into the show. Like, I'll buy, you know, ad space on Facebook and stuff, but I don't know how much that works. I mean, there's times where I've taken out an ad for $20, and it's gotten, like, you know, 50 likes or something, and then there's, like, 12 people at the show.
Right.
Or there's been a time where I've taken out an ad for $5, and there's been 30 people at the show. So I don't know, like, you know, what's working here.
Right.
But then I'll always ask people, I haven't seen them before, they're at the, how'd you hear about the show? And they just say, online, you know, we just, like, looked at things to do, you know. So I'm like, okay, I guess I'll keep doing that, you know. And I put whatever free listing I can do, like whatever the Journal Star paper listing online, or Eventful, or any of these places that will let you list your event for free. That way, if anybody Googles comedy in Lincoln, hopefully my event will pop up and they'll see it, you know.
Interesting. I have the same battle right now with the podcast. Yeah. Is there's no money in it. I mean, it's all out of my pocket.
And also, I'll see people come and they'll have a great time, and then I won't see them again.
Yeah,
the great show was great. It was so funny. We loved it. We're never coming back.
I had somebody, message me the other day. Hey, I love the podcast. I gotta start listening to it. Like, wait, what? So you love my audio that you haven't heard? That doesn't make any sense.
They listen to one show and they're like, they want to go back and listen to the archives.
That's, exactly.
It's like, that reminds me of like a Marx Brothers.
Yeah, no shit.
It's like, from the moment I picked up your book to the moment I laid it down, I was convulsed with laughter. Someday I intend reading it.
I knew exactly what you're talking about. The one thing that I can see with comedy in specifically Lincoln and Omaha area is that there's a lot of funny people. They don't want to move to either of the coasts to do comedy, but they want to do comedy. So it's just, I mean, it's going to take a lot of work, because you obviously know how hard it is to get somebody to come to a fucking comedy show.
Yeah.
I mean, but it's like, if some no-name band is playing cover songs, you know, songs they didn't even write, everyone goes to that.
Yeah.
It's like, do you know how fucking hard it is to write jokes? And it's a lot of work. I mean,
and people just don't know in Lincoln, don't know how to behave as audience members at a comedy show. They're used to seeing bands, so they think they can talk.
Yeah.
And it's like, no, you're going to ruin someone's punchline if you, like, you yell out something in the middle.
Yep, for sure.
That's really frustrating. And we'll, you know, sit back at the bar and talk like we're talking now, just slightly louder. Like,
yeah.
Oh, what's going on? Oh, there's somebody on. Oh, with a dream on stage? Oh, fuck that. I want to tell you about my, you know, Saturday.
You guys hear about this band?
Yeah.
Let me play them. I'll play them on my phone right now.
Yeah. I had a show one time at this place here in Lincoln, and it didn't work out. I won't say the name of the place, but it was like 10 o'clock on a Wednesday night. So that's already a terrible time to get people to come out. And one night I had this touring comedian from Colorado who's fantastic. His name's Sam Talent, and he's really, really, really great. And he was headlining. He was on stage, and then these like four businessmen came in. They were staying at like the Embassy Suites downtown.
Yeah.
And they came in, they sat down in the middle of the show and just started talking like there wasn't anything going on, just talking like that, you know. And Sam, who's a really great comic, like dealt with them a little bit and was funny, but then they didn't faze them. They still kept talking.
So I was like, yeah, whatever, dude. Anyways.
Yeah.
What the fuck?
So at the end of the show, I got up and said, thank you guys for coming, except for you three guys, or something like that. And then they said something sarcastic, and I just lost it. It was just like this years of built-up frustration with people like that. I'm like, motherfuck, listen, what the fuck? You're in Lincoln, Nebraska. If you want to drink a beer or have a drink and talk, there's a bar over there. There's a bar over there. There's a bar over there. There's a bar two blocks down that way. There's a bar that way. You can be loud as fuck in all those bars. But you say, you know, there's somebody on stage pursuing their dream. Let's go here and talk during that. It's not fun unless we're crushing dreams and booze.
Exactly. I mean, it just...
Because, I mean, I love stand-up comedy, but if I was going out with some friends and I was excited to catch up with my friends and talk, and I knew we were going to drink and talk, we walked into a place and there was comedy, I'd be like, oh, well, let's go someplace else. I don't want to, you know, risk talking over the comedians or anything, and I would go to a different bar. And luckily in Lincoln, Nebraska, there are lots of options. You know what I mean?
What are your plans right now? I guess, okay, let's talk about this. What shows are you doing regular right now, and what are your future goals and shows?
I do a show called Comedy Underground at Brewski's, because it's in the basement of Brewski's in the Haymarket, where they do a dueling piano show.
I have heard good things about that.
I do that on Thursdays. It's just only an hour. I usually host it, and then a headliner do like 30, 45 minutes. Or I'll have somebody else host it, and then someone do a short set, and then a headliner do like 30 minutes. But it's a real quick stand-up comedy show, and then the pianos come out, and it works really well together. And it's only $5 for the whole night. Nice. So that's a good deal.
Wait, so you can do the comedy and then stay for dueling all for $5?
Yep.
Holy shit. Okay.
Yeah. And they do that every Thursday. And then on every Sunday, I do the Zoolarious at the Zoo Bar.
Mm-hmm.
And I just want, my immediate goals are to keep building those shows up, keep building up the Lincoln comedy scene, and have more comedians that are touring that I admire come through and headline the show, and right, get locals on the show too, so they can network with them and meet them, and we get more people to come out and support live stand-up comedy. I really am interested, not so much as in like, I mean, I had Kyle Kinane on, because mm-hmm. Kyle's an old friend of mine, so, and you know, it worked out in his schedule that he had a Sunday night open. It was Mother's Day, but it was still sold out, and it was nice. A Zoo Bar, you know, and that was awesome, you know. But I'm more interested in people that are on the cusp of being Kyle Kinane, or on the cusp of right. being Louis C.K., or like people that I just totally believe in and think are hilarious, you know, that also aren't going to cost me an arm and a leg.
Right.
And I don't have to deal with fucking some agent bullshit.
Mm-hmm.
Because, like, I don't like dealing with agents. So just the agent speak is kind of being, it's, I'm like, look, it's just a little show in Lincoln, Nebraska. We get this many people. We're going to pay them this much money. I don't know about all your
demands.
Yeah. So it's easy to book a comic before they've reached that level, because then they're easy to deal with. And if I'm friends with them, they can just, you know, I have a 2-bedroom apartment. They can stay in the extra bedroom, you know, save on a hotel. And
see, that's kind of my whole goal with this podcast, is like, my direction is, yes, on all other thousands of podcasts, it's always like, if I was going to do specifically comedy, people only focus on who everybody knows. But there's so many people in this world that are not famous to everyone, and they're doing amazing things.
Yeah.
And that's the whole goal of it. And I really want to get a lot of comedians on, a lot of like musicians on, that are, like you said, right there where they're just about to hit and mm-hmm. explode. Because I guess long term, it would be nice to interview somebody, and then if they were to hit it big, interview them after,
right?
To see the before and after and what they've
learned.
Also,
it's way more satisfying and fun to watch someone's journey. You know what I mean?
Exactly.
To see, you can be, you know, you say, I saw them at the Zoo Bar for $5 yep. in 2012, and now they have their own Comedy Central hour. You know, like. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, everybody loves those stories.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, I saw...
But bands have the same struggle. I mean, like, there's so many great, amazingly talented bands out there, and people would rather pay like $80, $100 to go see Florida Georgia fucking shit line yeah. at the Pinnacle Bank Arena instead of walking to, you know, a few blocks up the street to the Zoo Bar to right. pay $5 to see an actual band with talent
mm-hmm.
that's toured the country for 20 years, that's earned it,
yep.
not two fucking douche nozzles with fucking wallet chains and fucking Scott Stapp hair and man Scott jewelry Stapp. And fucking and domestic beer sponsorships. Fuck you guys. I hate those guys so much.
Is it,
and Luke Bryan, like all that stuff is so shitty, you know.
I noticed that
because I grew up in small towns too, so like I hate that pandering to people in small towns. Like, it's like, that's not everybody in small towns. Isn't like a lot of dirt roads
oh,
and
every
trucks
single
and,
song
yeah,
yeah.
ponds
oh my God.
And lakes and also trucks and dirt roads and beer and also beer.
I run into that a lot.
Boys around here led back beer. Don't really care for queers. That's the subtext.
No shit. The true meanings.
Like Blake Shelton's music, I fucking hate it, but I don't mind him. Like, I like right. I watch The Voice actually, because I, for the same reason that I like this see people get discovered, especially mm-hmm. if they're like my age or older. You know, like somebody like is in their like, you know, 30s or 40s. and they have been touring around and struggling, and they have a shot on that show. I love that.
Right.
But on the other hand, I hate when teenagers are on. I never want to see a teenager do well ever. not on a reality show or entertainment. It's always the same, like some like 15-year-old girl. It's like, I've wanted this for so long. Really? How long? How long have you wanted it? Early 2015? Yeah. That's 2 years. Long you've wanted it? I've wanted it since your parents were in high school. Like,
that was the beauty of American Idol, was you got to see people think that they were good and just get destroyed. I mean, they in their small little world, they probably thought, I'm so good at singing, and they get up there after all these people and they realize you're not even close. It's like if I try to do a bodybuilding competition right now, they would just be like, why are you here?
I never understood that lack of self-awareness. Is even you see it in comedy too. Someone that's just like, you know, I respect the tenacity and the not ever giving up, but it's also a point that's like, you know, do you understand futility? Like, I mean, if I didn't, like the first, you know, couple months of me doing stand-up comedy, if I didn't get enough consistent laughs, I wouldn't have stuck with. I would have. Oh, this isn't for me. You know, like I also had a theater and a speech background growing up, so I was really. I've always been pretty comfortable in front of speaking in front of people,
right?
Which is half the battle, really. You know what I mean? Like, but I've seen comedians, like especially in LA, that just show up again and again and again, and I've never seen them ever get a laugh, not once ever. Like, it's like, what is keeps you going?
Yeah, that's what I don't understand. How could you, that I would have like panic attack. Yeah. I mean, how could you keep going up every night knowing you haven't gotten any? I don't know. It's got to change something, man. Either your act or your career or something.
That's the thing, that not changing anything, just like thinking, oh, your audience is eventually going to catch up to your shitty act.
Right. That's, I had a note in here to talk about, like, you probably saw it being out in LA of people who are not good at stand-up comedy, but they find a different direction and they just blow up. Like, I always tell people about, what's his name that is one of the writers on Seinfeld, the creators of it, and then he...
Larry David?
Larry David, yeah. If you've ever seen a stand-up,
yeah.
Oh, it's bad. But him as a writer is amazing. Like, Curb Your Enthusiasm is so fucking funny because he can express comedy better through writing and acting, but he can't really do it with stand-up. And it's just amazing.
Well, first episode of that show, it was him. They were going to have him do an HBO special.
Really?
And then he just had all this anxiety about it and came up with all these excuses not to do it. Like, oh, yeah, the Curb Your Enthusiasm was one of my favorite shows ever.
It's so good. So good.
Yeah.
And sometimes, you know, like Seinfeld, it takes a lot of work to get something to become good because the first couple – I love Seinfeld.
Well, he's probably the hardest working comedian there is. I mean, like
– Yeah.
He is old school, but also still, but doesn't seem dated. You know what I mean? Because it's him. I mean, like, that's him. Like, he helped patent that style. He works hard all the time. And he likes tweaking jokes. He likes the science of comedy, which I do too. Like, just the fact you can say a phrase and just switch a couple words around or, you know, and it's 10 times funnier.
Yep.
I love that. I think that's just so interesting, you know?
Yeah, I do.
I remember I watched. Did you see Seinfeld's comedian movie?
Oh yeah,
he was throwing out all the old act and coming up with a new one. And
yeah, I can't.
But just
what
the scenes of like him and Chris Rock and Colin Quinn. That's runs a funny bone in Omaha. I always do that. Colin Quinn just sitting around talking about comedy, you know, like bouncing ideas off each other,
right?
And then Colin Quinn goes, you have the friends that have conspiracy theories. They don't, like, you're at the movie theater. You go to get a straw. Go, don't grab the first straw. They put their balls in those straws. And Seinfeld's like, balls and straws. That works well together. That's funny. That sounds funny together. They put their balls in those straws.
Dude, Colin Quinn was so funny. He had that.
He still is.
He was just so good at being like an angry, funny, but you didn't take him as angry. You were like, yeah, it's like the guy's complaining, but it's funny how he's doing it.
It's not like reminds you of a blue collar guy,
yeah,
telling it like it is.
Yep, kind of like David Leary, just without all the screaming.
Dennis Leary,
not David Leary. Jesus, but well, yeah, just how they're always angry.
Colin Quinn was also, I heard he was one of the comics, like when he does like the Comedy Cellar in New York, that all the comedians will come into the room, in the back of the room, and sit and listen to him and laugh. Like, he's like the quintessential comedian's comedian. Like, comedians really love and respect him and want to hear him.
He just doesn't turn it off. Yeah. He's just naturally just funny all the time.
Yeah.
Interesting. Because some guys, they get on stage, they're hilarious, and they get off, and they have there's just no personality there. It's like, wow, what changed between the four steps you just walked down?
That could be refreshing, though, too, because you don't want someone that's on all the fucking time. Like, sometimes you see, like Will Ferrell or Jack Black on, like, a late-night talk show, and they're just, like, so manic and all over. You're like, dude, we all think you're hilarious.
Right.
You've proven you're hilarious. Just relax a second.
That's why, do you ever watch Seinfeld's Comedians?
I love it.
Getting Coffee? Yeah. I just love it so much because it's just them talking. Mm-hmm. Like, in those old stories.
I could literally watch comedians talk. Oh, to each other, talk, especially comedy, all day. Like,
right. The stories and how it was and, you know, their trials. I could listen to it all fucking day. They're great, great stories. Especially some of those guys that came up in the boom, like that late 80s boom, to hear what it was like then. I don't know. I think comedy, if you just got into comedy and just kept going at that time, you could have got something out of it. Mm-hmm. Because people were so... just boner jams over anything comedian at that time. Because there's a lot of guys who got famous in the late 80s that are not good. And they still just... But those are the same guys who are doing the exact same act decades later, because that's all they ever had was that one good
act.
That's
what I'm refusing to... That's what I don't understand. To evolve.
You know,
everything evolves. Like, your act should evolve, too. I mean, I do certain jokes that I wrote 20 years ago. But I've changed it, tweaked it to where it still means something to me. You know what I mean? Like, it's like once you're not there emotionally for a joke, if you don't relate to it anymore, you're just like repeating it with, and you know, people can tell, they can pick up on that when you're not into it anymore. Like, I always tell young comedians, I say, remember the emotional place you were at in your head when you wrote that joke and go there. It's basically, it's acting. I mean, it's like, you know, because you've said it tons of times already, but if you wanted to still get laughs, it needs to come out naturally. And so you need to put yourself in that headspace you were when you originally wrote it and feel it.
When you said that you used to write every word and pause and all that, how do you write now?
Just I said I really don't actually write.
You just do the on stage?
On stage and record it.
Is that because like...
I'll jot down if something pops in my head, I'll jot down like little notes so I try to remember it, you know, to try on stage. But I don't really sit down and actually write long... Because I used to write, like, I have an idea, and I'd write, like, you know, a couple paragraphs, you know, and not trying to necessarily be hilarious, just what my ideas were on, and then try to find the jokes in somewhere in there.
Right.
And just trim all it off, and you find, like, maybe you find one sentence, and like, aha! You know?
That's because I heard some podcast the other day where they were talking about how different comedians write, and somebody said, like, Bill Burr doesn't write anything. It's all just off his head. And I thought, wow, I just don't have the memory to be able to.
It's planned out, though.
Right.
I mean, yeah.
But it's just, like, even, like, and you said, like, you have an idea and you just write it down, like, I'll work on that later. I fucking forget it, even if it was a day later.
And I always write out set lists. I love writing set lists. Like, I'll write just a couple words that remind me what that chunk of material is. Mm-hmm. And then I'll write it all down in the order I'm going to do it. And then I'll fold it up and put it in my breast pocket or my back pocket. So I never look at it.
Mm-hmm.
But just to have it on me, you know, and it organizes it in my head. So if I'm doing like an hour, it flows.
That's how I do this podcast. I try and describe that to people. We do the same thing as I'll write out questions, but I don't bring that with me. Mm-hmm. It's just once I write it out, it's in my head. And then like sometimes if I hear a word or something, it'll trigger it. And I'm like, oh yeah, let's focus on that. Cause I remember I wanted to talk about it, but you know, sometimes it can alter. I mean, like I had this guy on a couple episodes ago, and it was the guy who owns the company I work for, XLNDT. We didn't even talk about welding inspection. We talked for 3.5 hours. And at the end of it, I was like, wow, we're going to have to do another one because we didn't even, like people were tuning in like, yeah, what is non-destructive testing? And at the end of it, they probably have no idea what it actually is because it turned into just stories and opinions and all kinds of stuff. But then next thing you know, I'm like, yeah, we're running out of time here.
And just do a quick explanation of what. Okay, this is what that is. Okay.
Yeah, like I had to do. I did an episode of explaining my life having glaucoma since I was born, and that's like every other sentence I have to say, look it up yourself, yeah. because I don't want to give you the scientific description because it's just going to put you to sleep. It's terrible. All those big
ass words.
Does
everybody ask if you smoke weed when you tell them
Every time. Every time. You got a weed card, man? Why don't you move to Colorado? Oh, that's all I ever get. It helps, but you got to smoke a lot for it to actually help your eyes. Back in the day, I read a stat that you had to smoke it like every at least once an hour.
Really?
Yeah, for it to work.
So you could see better, and but you can't get anything done.
Yeah, pretty much. No energy, but at least you can see you have no energy.
Yeah. At least you can clearly see the ceiling when you wake up from your nap.
Somebody told me that on the 2018, I'm so bad at politics, ballot or whatever, they're trying to get that in Nebraska now, where we can be like Colorado and have it legalized.
That'd be awesome. I just think Nebraska's, awesome. I always say Nebraska will be like the 50th state. Just out of spite. And then finally they'll be like, what? All 49? Ah, okay, fine.
All right, yep. No, that was when I heard it, I was like, yeah, it's great, it's on there, but we still haven't gotten a casino.
Yeah.
And all we do, I mean, literally what separates us from the casino is a river, and every old motherfucker in the state's like, yeah, just let the money go over to Iowa. Fuck it. Why would we want better roads and education and all that from casino money?
Yeah, because you hate hippies. That's exactly what it comes down to.
People, hate change.
Old people are still resentful of the hippie movement of the 60s. That's what they equate weed with.
Yep.
Not like a little kid that has epilepsy.
Yeah, you know? Exactly. I don't understand.
Or someone going through nausea from chemotherapy or AIDS, or, you know, like if someone has AIDS or cancer or epilepsy and they say, this works for me, who are you to argue with that?
That's exactly.
Okay, it works for you. Okay, let's fast track to legalizing that then.
Yep, that's what you're going to be doing. Yeah. I mean, it doesn't make any sense.
And it gets you intoxicated like alcohol does, except you don't want to fight ever.
Fight, wreck your car. Yeah. I mean, if you're stoned out of your mind driving a car.
Well, it's obviously that pharmaceuticals have a hand in that. They don't want weed to be legalized. They would take like so many of their out of business. They would lose so much money on that because their whole job is to keep you hooked to shit.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that pill's not working. Okay, we'll come back into the doctor's office, spend more money on the doctor's visit, then spend more money on getting this new prescription to see if that works. And then, you got an immunity to that now. Okay, here's a new prescription. Or you could just smoke weed.
that always bothers me when I go into a doctor's office and they have like ads up for new drugs.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm like, so really you're going to try and prescribe me something close to what you're pushing right now.
Yeah.
It's like, why do you have an advertisement of a drug?
You have a commission for that.
Yeah. This is a fucking business now. It's not
I say, go ask your doctor. I'm like, that's a drug dealer. That's
yeah, exactly. Exactly.
Hey man, you got this stuff.
I need it.
I need it. I don't care about the anal leakage or the blood from my
all
eyes.
All the side effects.
Steve Martin did a really funny thing about that. He had a book called Pure Drivel, which was comedy essays he'd written for New Yorker, all collected in one book.
Really?
And one that was called Side Effects. It was like, take two pills twice a day every 4 hours for joint pain. Side effects include joint pain. So, and it just went on through this huge litany of things. You also may experience pain and... while urinating, especially if the penis is caught between the seat and the bowl.
As we go in for the close on this podcast, what do you think is really holding back the comedy movement in Nebraska?
There's not enough of an audience for it yet. You know,
right.
There's obviously an audience for comedy, for fame, for celebrity comedians that come. I mean, Chappelle sold out four nights.
Right.
Mark Maron sold out Rococo. There was like 450 people or 425 people at Brian Posehn. Do you know who he is?
Oh, yeah.
So there's an audience for it. There's not enough people that go out to watch just to support, you know, to see young comedians or, you know, up-and-coming comedians. There's not enough support for it as of now, I don't see.
Interesting.
But, you know, Lincoln's not that big either. You know, I've gone to see bands that I loved and that, you know, there was eight people there. I'm like,
that's one thing I always tell myself with the podcast is, you know, it's going to take forever to get it to go because I just think of like, because I've played in the band before, So I've played shows where there's 10 people there, and it's like usually all of our parents.
Yeah.
So I have to remember back to that. It's like, yeah, all these big bands that everybody knows, they started out like that at one time.
Yeah.
Of you know, four people showed up, and you're playing to an empty room at some point. It's just, it's hard to keep going through that because you never know, is that going to go on for a year or 10 years? It's quite a hill to climb.
Yeah.
As far as the Lincoln scene goes, is there anybody that you are seeing right now where you're like, man, you can do it?
Jordan Klein?
I'm getting ready to message her to try and get her on the podcast.
Yeah, she'd do it for. She'd love to do it.
And I got her on Facebook. I just haven't had the time to send her a message because to book these are so hard because my schedule's so fucking goofy, as you're aware.
Yeah.
I've heard nothing but good things about her.
Oh, she's absolutely great.
Her name keeps coming up.
She's just really
people.
Naturally funny.
Yeah.
She's got really good jokes, too. She's from Grand Island, and she's a young lesbian girl, so that's, that perspective alone is hilarious. You know? But like, you know, but also where she breaks stereotypes, too, which is always funny. You know, it's not like, you know. And she's just really quick and funny, and she's ambitious as hell, and she listens to me.
That's why you're talking.
But no, she, because I have, you know, I do have some knowledge. I did, you know, I've done a few things. I've done the road enough, and I've gotten paid to do comedy. And, so she'll ask my advice, and then she'll follow through with it. You know, I've told her, you know, if you really want to, you know, get some more road gigs, you just need to reach out on your own.
Like,
find out who these people are, find out a way to contact them, send them an email. And she's done that, and it's worked out for her a few times.
That's awesome. That's one of the big reasons I wanted to get you on here is because I wanted to hear like your perspective because you've seen the whole circle. You've seen the comedy in a small area, a big area, on the road, off the road, you know, all that. So to get your thoughts and views, it really interests me to hear that. And I feel like that's why I just feel like you're going to have a big success with the showcases that you're doing because you know the hurdles that are already there. You're like, I've been there, man. I've seen it. It's like, here's what we got to do. We're going to skip to point B quicker than anybody else. Because what they're going to, you know, if somebody started the showcase night now, they're going to run into the bumps in the roads that you already have. Mm. You're blowing right by them because you're avoiding all that. It's there.
Except occasionally I get stuck in a ditch. No. I hope so. I want it just to be a thing that people just do. You know what I mean? Sunday nights, let's go to the Zoo Bar.
Right.
Comedy, we know it's always going to be consistently good.
See, that's what I would like it to be.
I was going to say with the Duffy's thing, and I love Duffy's. I think Duffy's is probably got to be the oldest comedy, just comedy-focused open mic in the country, I'm thinking. It's been over 30 years it's been around. But people... The one bad thing about it is a lot, especially college kids or people that aren't that familiar with stand-up comedy, they think that's what it is, that just anybody, every comedy show is an open mic.
Right, you know? Right. Yeah, exactly.
I'm like, no, this is a show where I've watched these people and I've thought that they had something and I've booked a small number of them, so the show's not going to be longer than 90 minutes and you're not going to see anybody that, you might not think, you'll think some are funnier than the others, probably, but that's just personal taste. But you're not going to be like feeling bad or anybody for anybody, you know, or like pity laughing anybody. Hopefully, you
seeing
know?
Bombs go off.
Yeah,
no one's bombing.
Yeah,
no, that's a great point because then people take the mood because like a lot of times in Duffy's, yes, the stage is separate from the bar, but too many times the college kids come in there during the open mics and
they get a bad idea because open mics, you know, it's open to anybody. Homeless people, fucking sadists, fucking sexists, fucking assholes, like, and they can just spout any kind of hateful, shitty stuff.
Yep.
And then people are like, I don't like stand-up comedy because they ain't really mean.
Yeah.
They say really sexist things. It's like, no, that one shitty person who's ever been paid to do comedy in his life that you saw at an open mic did.
Yep.
But that's not a, you know, if a show you're paying money to go see a comedy show, you're generally going to have a good time.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's like, but people like getting that, even comedians that start out doing comedy, they're like, I don't know, comedy just seems like there's a lot of bad people. Like, there's a lot of bad people everywhere. It's an open mic. It's open to anybody. You know what I mean? Like...
Open to public.
Yeah. If you can't sit through one shitty comedian, then you shouldn't be doing comedy. Your skin is not thick enough.
No shit. You gotta have some thick skin. My last question is, what's the best... I want to say what's your best memory that you've had, or like what's your best memory, best show, you know, best place you ever played? You're like, fuck, I
don't have the one really. I have right. So Joan Rivers shows were so amazing. It's hard to choose one. Well, I'll tell you too. One of them I was opening for Joan in Shreveport, Louisiana. It was two days before my birthday, and one of my best friends that I've known since we were 13. It was a last minute gig, and I usually had to pay for my flights. That was the money was usually good enough that I'd still, you know, make good enough money.
Nice.
But this was kind of last minute, so I was like kind of going, oh, should I get a flight? Or my friend that I've been friends with forever, he's a travel junkie. He's driving all over the country. He's also a genius. He knows how to fix cars. He's a problem solver. He's a great guy to have as a friend.
MacGyver.
Yeah, basically. And he's like, well, shit, dude, I just did the math. It's actually cheaper on gas if we just drive. Why don't we just want me to drive, and we'll drive, and we'll go to the Joan Rivers show. And then so we went to Shreveport and did that, and that was fun as hell. And Joan really liked him, too. He was hanging out backstage talking and everything. And his girlfriend at the time had just broken her nose. She got hit by a car and hit the hood of the car.
Fuck.
And he asked Joan if she would sign the program for her. And Joan goes, sure, okay. And he told her the whole story. And she signed it. She goes, I hope she has a sense of humor. And it said, lucky you. You get a brand new nose. Love, Joan Rivers. But then after the show ended, I got to stay in Shreveport. They put me up in a hotel. And then the next day we drove to New Orleans. It was my first time in New Orleans.
Mm-hmm.
So him and I went and walked. That's just when comedy enables you to go on a paid vacation.
Right.
And we went to New Orleans and went down Bourbon Street. We're having the time of our lives. I love New Orleans. It's fantastic. It lives up to the hype for sure. And at midnight I turned 38. And the next day we got up early and we drove to Memphis and went to Beale Street and just messed around on Beale Street. So I turned 38 on Bourbon Street and Beale Street. So that was a good one.
That's fucking
And the other
sweet.
One is a story. It was about my worst bombing, but it ended up being a great story to tell. I was another Joan Rivers show in the Hilton Casino in Atlantic City. And it was like the crowd just hated me. I was just doing terrible. They weren't into anything that I was saying. I wasn't winning them over. And I had to do like 25 minutes. And there was this guy and his wife in the front row who were heckling me. I barely even remember what they were saying. I just remember they were trying to talk to me and being rude. And like 15 minutes into my 25-minute set, the wife starts looking at her watch going, are you done? Are you done?
Jesus.
And I thought I should say, is that what you say to your alcoholic husband when he's on top of you? But I didn't say that because I thought of that like 3 hours later in my hotel.
Right.
It didn't count.
Damn it, I got to go back.
So I barely finished that set. I mean, I got my 20, got to the 25 minutes, and I'm getting off the stage. And I see Joan. She always passed me and usually would smile and pat me on the back. And now she this one night, she just looked pissed. And my first thought was it was my fault. I didn't win him over. They hated me. I just bombed in front of Joan. I'm never working again. My career is over. I'm a piece of shit. You know, just a total downward spiral. And she comes out, and this guy and his wife start trying to talk to her, too. And she immediately looks at him. She goes, okay, you've obviously had too much to drink. Let me see your drink, sir. He hands his full drink up to her. She grabs it out of his hand, throws the drink in his face, throws the glass at his head. She goes, security, I want this fucker out of here. Because I'm fucking serious. I want him out. No, don't be standing back there. Get up here. Take him fucking out of here. How about this? I'm going to walk off the stage, and I'm not coming back till he's fucking gone. How's that? She just walks off the stage.
That's fucking awesome.
And then they finally took this guy and his mean wife out. And then she comes back and the audience went crazy. Like,
that's
and then she killed.
Legit.
But it was like shitty to bomb that bad, but it was also cool to see her, you know, and also have my back, you know?
Oh, yeah, for sure. As I mean, how many headliners would give a shit about their... Yeah,
not many.
No.
No.
That is an awesome story. Fuck. Where... I don't. I want to end it on that.
Yeah.
Where can people find you? Where can they stalk you at?
On Facebook. I think it's Facebook.com/Brad the Comedian is my fan page, or just Brad Stewart if you want to be my friend. And I'm at Brad the Comedian at Twitter. Is it at Twitter? I don't know what the kids say.
No. On Twitter?
My at tweet, Brad the Twitter? Comedian.
I don't know.
Pretty easy to remember. There was already a Brad Stewart on there when I signed up for Twitter, so I just used Brad the Comedian. Say YouTube, but I don't have anything on YouTube really that I'm proud of right now. So
that's what I keep getting from everybody.
You can type in my name and might be some old videos that pop up. But.
Yeah. And then you got a website, right?
Oh, yeah. BradStewartComedy.com.
Awesome.
Which also needs updated. But you get the gist. I have some videos up there, too. And,
yeah.
And yeah, some upcoming dates. And always Sunday at the Zoo Bar. That's what I want people to come to the most. And Thursdays at the Comedy Underground at Brewski's in the Haymarket, too.
Nice. Now, I was going to say, maybe if they want some updated stuff, they should get the fuck out there
yeah.
and go to some shows.
Absolutely.
Well, thanks for coming on, man.
Man, thanks for asking me.
I appreciate
it.